Hi folks, welcome back. I hope you're all doing well. So it's getting towards the end of the year and I wanted to do a couple of videos that are different from just looking at a paper. And today I want to get very concrete and talk a little bit about how I use AI in my day-to-day personal and professional life. This will make a bit more sense if you know about what I do for work. I'm an engineering manager at an AI startup called Emergence. And before that, I spent a long time at Google in many different roles as an IC software engineer, tech lead, engineering manager. These days, most of my day-to-day professional work is organizational and management and architecture and design with a little bit of coding. But I do code pretty regularly for personal stuff, little tools I cook up for my own convenience, or just to explore and learn. Which brings me to my first big use of AI, which is for programming. I use LLMs for programming a ton, and I think by now they're as basic of a tool as using IDEs. Small aside, I see a lot of takes that say using LLMs for coding is not a good idea. And I think there's room for some nuance, but it is a really powerful tool. Even if you're just learning, you've got to use it the right way. But not using it is definitely not the right way to approach this. Anyway, that's a tangent. I have other posts on my blog and other videos on this channel that talk about that aspect. But speaking of programming, my two main tools are GitHub Copilot that I mostly use in VS Code, and ADER on the command line. A lot of the coding I do is in Python, and LLMs in general and Copilot specifically are really great at Python, probably because they've seen so much Python in their training set. And overall, I'm pretty happy with GitHub. Its performance on Python is almost always spot on, and I'm familiar enough with the language that if it produces something that I don't like, I can quickly edit it or just regenerate it. I've almost never seen it produce egregiously buggy or flat out wrong code. And all the other features around Copilot are pretty useful as well. Things like slash explain to explain some convoluted piece of code. But the other tool I use a lot is ADER. And I use it with Claude 3.5 Sonnet, and that works astonishingly well. I know GitHub just announced multi-file edit at GitHub Universe a couple of days ago, but ADER is the tool which originally did multi-file edits using agentic looping behavior, but it's based on using it from the command line rather than an IDE. And I use it for heavier multi-file edits, things like creating a new project with some basic functionality or generating tests from an existing code base. I use it a lot for reviewing, where if I make a quick messy first pass of the code and then I want to clean it up, it works really well for that. And then, of course, the core ADER use case, which is multi-file edits, works pretty well for large refactors that touch a lot of files. And this, of course, works well if you pair it with generating tests. So it's a good way to get a quick first draft of a code base working and then ping pong between generating tests and refactoring and then making that code base robust and extensible. The funny thing is, ADER tells you how much your session cost, and it's kind of funny to see when it reports a cost that is tiny, something like a few cents, after it has generated hundreds of lines of code for me, something that would have taken me anywhere between half an hour to a couple of hours. The thing to note is that ADER and Copilot work very differently. One, of course, works in the IDE, and the other one works on the command line. But also, ADER is a bit more autonomous in that it generates a multi-step plan for accomplishing the task you've asked it to do, and then it uses agents to go and do them. And it's interesting to see how with tools like Cursor, these two modes, copilots and agents, are beginning to unify. The other thing I spend a lot of time doing is just consuming media. I read stuff on the web, I watch lots of videos on YouTube, and I've cooked together a few utilities for myself that make that a bit faster or efficient. I have a little script which summarizes Hacker News stories. It uses the Hacker News API, goes and fetches the story that the entry is talking about, as well as the comments, and then summarizes the two of them together. Another tool I use a lot, because I watch YouTube a lot, is a YouTube video summarizer. So the simple take on a video summarizer is to transcribe the video, and often they'll have transcripts attached to them in YouTube, and then simply prompt an LLM to summarize transcript. But what I wanted to do was create a video transcript. I wanted to create an edited down version of the original video. And this was something that would have been really hard to do without LLMs. But with LLMs, this becomes a lot more tractable. The thing you need is word-level timestamps on the transcription of the video, and Whisper can do that. And then I prompt an LLM to construct a summary that consists only of direct quotes. And then if you find those quotes and you combine them with the word-level timestamps, you can then emit an edited-down version of the original video. So conceptually, this is pretty simple. There's some fiddly code that has to do with timestamps and so on, and finding quotes within the transcript. But overall, this works great. I use it a lot on long videos. And then there's some videos I'll go and watch in full, but then a lot of long videos or podcasts or lectures, I'll get almost everything that I wanted to get from the video by looking at a much shorter summary that this tool produces. Another very common use case for me is chat with PDFs. So when I quickly want to understand a research paper, I'll attach the PDF into a ChatGPT session and ask questions about it. I've also been using the search feature, search over the web, ever since it was announced a few weeks ago. And it has actually taken a fairly large chunk of my Google search volume. I think web-grounded RAG is now getting pretty good. All right, so from consuming to creating, I use LLMs a fair bit in my writing workflows as well. And there's two main themes that I use it for. One is creating some kind of structured output from unstructured stream of consciousness kind of input. And the other is to just get started on some big writing project. An example of the first one is taking a brain dump of a discussion during a meeting or just some ideas that I want to write out, and then asking the LLM to create a more logically laid out version of that very unstructured random brain dump. The other workflow is just getting over the blank page, either getting an outline of something I want to start writing, or as I'm writing it, using it as a Socratic partner to pressure test ideas or add more detail to ideas. This is fairly common. I think everyone does this kind of stuff when they're writing with LLMs. There are also a bunch of miscellaneous personal utilities and random use cases that have helped me out quite a bit. I will often prompt ChatGPT to create a math quiz on some kind of specific topic, usually for elementary school, and then, you know, hand the device to my kids to go do that math quiz. Works pretty well. For this channel, I'll dump the transcript of a recorded video and ask ChatGPT or Claude does pretty well at this, to suggest chapter titles and timestamp markers, so taking a video and dividing it into chapters. Another utility I wrote recently, which helped me out quite a bit, I thought it was cool, was to go over my screenshots directory, where every file name is off the form screenshot-date, so it doesn't tell you much about what's in it unless you go actually open it and view it. And then use a vision model to emit a description of it and a language model to give it a short descriptive file name. And it seems like a really small and simple thing, but it makes a huge difference. Now you can actually make sense of what's in your folder and quickly find the things you want. Another thing I've started to do recently is put my to-do list into ChatGPT and then just talk to it as I'm going through those things. It's a chatty to-do tracker. And you might ask, well, how is that different from just having a simple checklist app? The thing is, it's conversational. I can ask things like what's left to do or give it instructions in natural language. Things like, okay, I don't need to do something anymore, take it off the list or move it to another list for tomorrow. And it can maintain that state throughout the conversation. Quick note on tooling for almost all my code and command line usage. I use Simon Willison's LLM package. It's a Python package that has both a library and a command line tool. And it can invoke pretty much every LLM under the sun, all the big hosted ones, Gemini, GPT-4, Claude, etc., as well as LLMs that run locally with Ollama and so on. And it's just an indispensable tool when working with or coding with LLM. So thank you, Simon. All right, so overall, I've been using AI and LLMs pretty deeply in a lot of my workflows for coding, for consuming media, for writing, all that stuff. There's still a few places where I think there's a lot of friction. The number one pain point for me is deployment. And maybe this is just a blind spot for me, but I'm guessing other people run into this as well. The problem here is going from a quick Python script that solves a problem for me locally and then wrapping it up as an application that can be deployed somewhere on the cloud so that it can run on or run from any machine. It's not tied to just my local machine that happens to have that Python code on. And to do this, you have to do things like Dockerize it and then run it on the cloud somewhere using one of the many cloud services that accept Docker containers and then run them. And all these building blocks exist, but there's still a lot of friction in getting them running the first time and then looking after them and just having this really giant gulf between a script quickly working locally and then deploying it in a more portable fashion. I wish there was something really quick and easy to solve this. The second problem, even though it sounds strange to say, is prompting. It's still a bit of a black art. There are all these tricks that you have to know, and you have to think about how to construct the prompt. And a big part of it really is that writing a clear prompt forces you in turn to clearly think about the problem you want to solve. That's part of it, but there's still a lot of other tricks you have to know. Another thing I wish was easier, and this is very related to the deployment point I just spoke about, is running LLMs in the background. I know this is mostly just hooking it up to a cron job, but I'd like to trigger LLM calls periodically in the background and do things for me. But yeah, this is similar to the deployment pain point. So overall, I've been using LLMs a lot. I'm pretty happy with how they've helped me in my day-to-day workflows. I think everyone should be trying out how to use them and if these tools could be useful to them in their day-to-day work. I'll leave a link to this blog post in the description of this video. If you like content like this, please consider subscribing, like the video, and I will see you next time. Thank you very much.